Inside, no.
I've walked among the shadows, you wiped my tears away. And I've felt the pain of heartbreak, and I've seen the brighter days. And I'll pray prayers to heaven from my lowest place. And I have held the blessings God you give and take away. And no matter what I have, your grace is enough. No matter where I am, I'm standing here alone. On the mountains, I'll open my life to the one who sent me there. In the valley, I'll lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, again, no matter what, I know I'm safe inside your head. On the mountains, I will bow my life to the one who sent me there. In the valley, I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I stand on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley,
I'm
I'm only, well, I'm seeing my camera. I'm only seeing my camera.
Raheem was a fun, loving character, and it was a pleasure and an honour to play alongside him as well as know him. Raheem used to always make me laugh with a smile on his face and was always telling jokes. For example, with me and him used to literally go back and forth, mimicking each other's accents during the game. And this is when we were supposed to be defending, actually focusing on the game, but we had time to do that. And that's what he brought that sense of fun back to the game. And I'm surely really gonna miss that as well. But that's not just all he did. He was always there for the young players, helping support, mentor them. And that's what he should be remembered for. And that's what he'll always be remembered for. He was always there to just be on hand and support us all. And we're surely gonna miss him, myself, the players. And that's the effect he's had on anyone he's known. He's literally affected all our lives. But Raheem, my brother, just obviously I wish you all the best in the afterlife and the rest in eternal peace, and may God protect you now and forever. Thank you.
So guys, thank you for coming as you say goodbye to Raheem. In one word, what did Raheem mean to you?
A brother.
Friendship.
Trustworthy.
My sister.
Magnetic.
Honest. Angel. Loyal. Lovely.
Genuine.
Joy.
Pure. Family. Loving.
Bravo. Sweetness.
So Raheem from Lyman and me.
God, my community.
Report nothing to the advocate that we have. The Lord here, the Lord takes away. Let the Lord in
the Lord. The Lord is the Lord. And finally, the last.
I have sister and son.
Right at the time,
expecting, and I now have my immediate reason to return to that distance. And that reason, of course, was my son, Raheem. My own son, my first child. And one of the main reasons that I made that decision to come back to Trinidad to live was because I did not want to be another irresponsible black man not taking care of his children. So it immediately became a number one priority for me to be there as his father. Not for long distance. Not through alimony or child support. Not through the courts. That's a father. A black father. And so for the first 6 months of my son's life, I was with him. I was just left the country, but with him. I'm taking care of him every day. Changing him, bathing him, taking him out, walking with him. As a newborn baby. And I knew that kind of history between a father and a son would create the kind of bond that is needed between black men and their sons, sons with their fathers, and both sons and fathers with their grandfather. I was mindful of this from day one. As a student of Minister Louis Farrakhan, who I heard speaking about fatherhood, so that's the kind of man that I was. That's the kind of man that I chose to be. And I was able to produce a son who I already knew was great, but now. With all of these tributes and pledges and statements of support and love from all over the world. So I already believe that I have a good son, but now the world knows that he was a great man. The amount of people from England, his teammates at Wembley FC, at the London Jaguars, two football teams that he played for, Swansea FC, where he did a trial, they all said statements of love, support for the family. His work colleagues. They sent a video of about 20 of them lined up. And the person recording the video asked each of them, in one word, what did Raheem mean to you? And each of them one after another, say respectful, loving. Caring, kind, strong, disciplined. Now, there are some people who say, I'm a good man, and I appreciate that. But if I'm a good man, producing a son like that is a major reason. All of this, but all of it, St. Xavier. St. Mary's College, Sky, Joe Public, Chapelity, Central FC, the University of West Indies football team, James Bar, all teams that he played for, and all groups that set them up and support. So, Roddy was born on November 7, 1992. And just a few months ago, embraced Islam. I wanted to give him a holy name. Raheem, which means merciful. As it appears 114 times in the Holy Quran, one for every chapter, but not at the beginning of chapter 8, two in chapter 26. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Raheem means merciful. But I also gave him as a middle name, Bihar. So on his passport is Raheem Bihar. And by honor, he carries the name that was given to me, Muhammad, 1996. Raheem as a baby was troublesome, as all babies are. But he was my companion. The first 6 months, he was my friend. He started playing football. And I wrote with karate, Purple Dragon, under Professor Don Jacob. He got an orange belt. And he said, you prefer football? I said, you stop. He said, yes, I'm going to write. I didn't mind him playing football as opposed to karate. But a coach came along one day. Like, I had done it with my son, running, he had speed, he had pace. Able to rip through all those other teams that we played in the college team. All the other schools, except for the college. But a coach came up to me when I was about 8, 7 and said, you're starting to go. I said, no, we're not. Yes, he is. And the focus shifted. But Raheem landed on the ring, he still played for London Jackals as an off-field player. So now we're playing love. That goalkeeper book, sending him on a train course to the goalkeeper. Of course, he did well. He played for St. Mary's College and the National Under 17. And he went to St. Xavier's private school in St. Joseph and St. Mary's College. Then he went to the University of West Indies. And then, in the middle of his playing football as well, he went to England to live. I would be lying to you. If I were to tell you that I was not, I'm sure all of you would be the same to some degree. I would be lying to you if I were to say that I did not feel some sense of relief knowing that my son was out of Trinidad. But this is a dangerous place. Right here in this office, I've spoken to so many parents, mothers, and brothers who lost their sons. I have visited the homes of so many families who have lost their sons younger than Raheem was, 29. Let me tell you this. I got angry with a lot of people over the last week. First of all, people I got the news from, I was angry with them. Speaking to the police on the phone, I was angry with them. I have to publicly apologize for threatening the last people who spoke. I was angry with them. I was angry with the forensic people. Because I'm going to talk about this at another time, not today, but it seems like the state is more interested in testing dead bodies for COVID-19 when they know they did not die from COVID-19. And this funeral has been taking place since Wednesday or Thursday. Today is Saturday because of the state's obsession. Tested people who fell off a ladder and drowned, got hit by a car. Tested them for COVID-19 in their desperation to rank up those figures again and then report to the public. And then use that politically. It's disgusting. And they kept writing for the whole process delayed by at least 48 hours. Because of that wanting to test a body for COVID of a man that is wrong. But the point that I'm making though is, I want you to think about this. So like I said, over the last 6 days, I'm getting upset with people, I'm getting angry with people, but those people that I was getting angry with are people who are trying to help. Imagine being in a situation where someone takes the life of your son. If I am getting angry or feeling anger for a driver that arrives late, or a police officer that visits my home, or when I'm making an inquiry, or a doctor in the forensic hospital who does an autopsy before the son of mine, if I'm getting angry with that, imagine the anguish that so many people in this country are living with. Because by the last 24 hours, 5 people have been more young black men like Raheem. Listen, when your body feels pain, or when your body hurts, it's called pain. When your physical body hurts, it's called pain. But when your mind hurts, it's called confusion. And confusion sets in when you ask the wrong questions. The wrong questions. It does me for a moment here, please. someone have left something to me that you consider to be very valuable. I used this analogy yesterday. Let's say a watch. Let's say someone has a very expensive diamond watch that you admire. You say, wow, that watch is amazing. And then they say to you, like this morning, I'm going around the corner for 5 minutes. Put this on and wear it for me. You put on the watch. Yesterday we were talking about, imagine like a parent. You're the 8 or 9 or 10 years old. And they give you the key to the car to move it up the driveway. For the first time ever. Are you dreaming about car racing? And here you get an opportunity to move your father's car 3 meters. That's a major achievement at 87. So someone lends this watch to you just for 5 minutes and you're so happy about it. Now, imagine someone lends the same watch for 6 months. And then they come back to get it, and you think it, I got a customer. Started to be comfortable with it. Hey, it goes well in my dress, so. Ah, but I have to give it back. All right, but really enjoy that. You with me so far? But now, think of someone lending you this one, so valuable, you love it so much. And they said, I'm giving it to you, I'm letting it to you. But I'm going to come back to it at some point. And then, 29 years later, a mistake. Time to give it back. Now, listen to all the things. The fool is more focused on the person taking back the watch more so than the time that passed that they knew was coming. This life is not our own. Almighty God Allah says in the Quran, from him we come. And to him is our eventual return. You were already told that. So when someone lends you the watch or lends you the car, whatever item it is that you fall in love with, at what point do you start to labor under the illusion that it becomes to you? At what point? Everyone in here probably has a different answer. But I can assure you the answer will be 5 minutes or 7 minutes or 1 day or 2 days or a week or 2 weeks or even a month. But maybe after 4 or 5 or 6 years setting in, you might start to think, oh, wait a minute, I've become so comfortable with this. I've become so accustomed to this. This has now become a major part of my own life. So at some point in the mind, you cross that border of saying it no longer belongs to the owner, it now belongs to me.
Stay.
Man.
Stay.
Does not belong to you. To report the 78. Quran says, wherever you are, death will overtake you, even if you are in towers raised high. Some people say, oh, this is a dangerous place here. There's a lot of shooting and killing and stabbing. So this is a dangerous place. I'm going to leave here and I'm going to go up there where it's safe. But when you go up there where it's safe, you're still not in control of your own life. And if you think you are, you're wrong. This is why you have to put everything, not some things, everything in God's hands. But you see, mentally, we begin to drift. We get so comfortable with the walk, so comfortable with the car, we start to think it's mine now. It's not! The Quran says, running away from death will not profit you. It's repeated for you. Cannot. It's just simply something that you cannot do. You cannot run away from death because it just might be that exactly where you're running to. That's it. I want to say this difficult to think. It's something that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said to me on Wednesday before. I was explaining to him that with my son living in England, he kept delaying his flight to go back. So my son came there on November 5th. His birthday was November 7th. Spent all that time together. And then I left to go to England on December 7th. He was down there, I'm up there, in the home that he lives in, along with his sister, my daughter. So me and her are up there. Him and his mother, my wife, are here. And let me tell you something about this family. We video chat every day. Whether I'm here, over there, whether he is here, over there, whether Nina is here, over there, and Roxanne is here. Every day, we have that. It's, if it's not all four of us, it's at least three of us, definitely two of us. Every day. Sometimes we have these four phones on. We have each other on video. Everything. So, Raheem kept making his trip to go back to England. He was supposed to go back on December 24th. Then again, he was supposed to go back, I think it was today or yesterday, January 21st. Then he was looking at extending it again to March 18th. Don't treat that. And when I said that, when I explained that to Minister Barker, he said that while your son was delaying his return to England, God calling on him to return to him. That struck me. And I want to tell you one more thing that he said. I remember being, obviously I didn't take a whole lot of week, but something that he said that my mother also said. I haven't told anyone, I haven't taken time to process it. Tell it a little while. Everyone okay? You with me? Why is it so sad? Raheem, every day that goes out, comes back. Paul, did I say daddy, you come here? Yeah. bring something to you. All the time. My daughter does the same thing, but she doesn't go out for lunch. Right? Every night. Both, Daddy, want anything? So, this floor that you see, we just put down these tiles. This. Still haven't finished. I hope we can finish with those. Roger was here. Exactly, we can go around this time. Last photograph that I took of him, he was moving the tiles through the conference room. And when he was leaving, he phoned me. He said, Daddy, you need some help in the center? I said, yeah. He said, where are you? He told me where he was. He said, he's going to get some pies from Eastside Bakers. He said, you want any? I said, no, no. Then, when he put it out of here, he said, Daddy, I want to be 5 years. Cut it. But it would have been on the same day, Wednesday. My mother said to me, you know, it obviously grew conversation. My mother said, you know, still with us. And you can talk to him. And then she said, but not in a crazy way. She said, but he's still with us. You can talk to him. And nobody did anything. That is speaking to Mrs. Monica. He said, you know, you can talk to your son. You can ask him things and feel the spirit of how he was done. And you can draw out of him. That is why Allah said in the Quran, don't speak of those who have died in the cause of God as dead. No, they are alive, but you just don't understand. In the Bible, Jesus the Messiah was confronted, and often he was asking him one question. They came to Jesus and asked him, well, what if a woman marries a man, and then that man dies, and then she marries another man, and that man dies with her, then she marries another man, and that man dies, and then she has 7 husbands, and all of them die. In heaven, who will be the husband? And Jesus' response implied that that was a foolish question. Because of the way that we believe in God as a mystical, mythical, magical, non-detectable, non-existent, out there in space, or in the clouds, or in the sky, but not within. So Jesus said, in response to that question, God is not a God of the dead, God is a God of the living. And our loved ones live on by the love that we give to them. Who in their right mind would say that God loves them? And if you do, talk about my heart. Our son was acting as an example. My son, my only son, Raheem, did not bring out the heart. There are so many friends that came to testify that when they're out and they're drinking beer, he's drinking the water. My son, my only son, did not smoke. And to the best of my knowledge, he never even smoked. My son did not use obscene language. My son did not lose his temper with people. My son fasted for the month of Ramadan, even while he was playing football. And my son never spited anyone, with an actual evil against anyone, never slandered anyone. And I say to you, that when we speak about them and speak about Peter, we need to prepare it. How do you prepare to be saved? The bride of God, as he's present, and he's back to the record of kindness and love. But he had to put a post on his Facebook page to be helpful. Even to that, I love my parents more than anything else. But it's time to be saved. If we do that, I'm going to back up the views of the world. Then we can argue that would be the best time to return to the kingdom rather than I want to thank you so much for being patient with me. I want to thank you for being here. Too many people today, but of course, this conversation will continue over the next few weeks. I want to thank my father for conducting this service in a piece of the economy. And I will be back to you in a prayer. This is an event that can take 48 to 70 hours. I know that I've taken so much love for all over. And even now when I check my phone after the 15 minutes or so that I would speak. And there are several more to do that. So I want to thank you so much again for being patient with me for listening. I say you need opportunity to find the word.
On the third day, he descended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. Thank you. Allahumma, Allahumma, going to do, we're going to give Raheem a salute. And I'm going to give a command for the people of David. I'm going to give you a salute. You all going to raise our hands quickly. A salute. And then I will take very fast. And we will come down to the school. Ready, come on. This is my
one of us is in the heavens and on earth. Let it be clear that he created and promoted the law, for he has exalted it might the light. To him belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth. It is he who gives life and death, and he has power over all things. He is the first and the last, the evident and the imminent, and he has full knowledge of all things. He it is who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and is moreover firmly established on the throne of authority. He knows what enters within the earth and what comes forth out of it, what comes down from heaven and what mounts up to it. And he is with you wheresoever you may be, and Allah sees well all that you do. To him belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth, and all affairs are reverted back to Allah. He merges night into day, he merges day into night, and he has full knowledge of the secrets of our hearts. Finally, we have, of course, before, you know, some tributes from the friends, the organizations that our brother and he would have touched. So please allow me to read some tributes from the jurisdictions that wish to contribute something to these results. I begin with the Sky FC. Of course, football club. On behalf of the Sky fraternity, I would like to offer our sincere condolences to David, Roxanne, and Amina Muhammad. Thank you for letting us have the opportunity to get to know your son and brother, an unforgettable human being in every positive sphere of life. Raheem, wherever you are an inspiration to all around you, and you will surely be missed by the Sky family. Never to be forgotten. Hashtag #BelgraveBirdie. The Emancipation Support Committee says the Board of Directors and staff of the Emancipation Support Committee of Trinidad and Tobago extend our deepest condolences to Brother David and Sister Roxanne Muhammad on the transition of their son, Raheem Belgrave Muhammad. We mourn with you the sudden and tragic loss of one of our young, talented sons, and can only imagine how devastating this must be for you and your family. May Raheem's transition be peaceful and safe, and may all his loved ones, friends, and colleagues receive the blessings of comfort and strength required at this difficult time. When BFC says, it is with terrible sadness that we bring news of Raheem, Billy, Belgrave's death. We are shocked and saddened and send our condolences to his family and friends. The Trinidad and Tobago Football Association says, the TTFA extends deepest condolences to the family of Raheem Belgrave, who passed away on Sunday. Raheem was a member of the men's national U-17 squad in 2008-2009 under then head coach Anton Fournier. He was a son of former national team manager David Muhammad. May he rest in peace. A brother by the name of Ian Brooks says he was decent, mature, and his ethical and moral turpitude was quintessential He gave of the time, he gave of his time to you, to his school, CIC, to his club, Sky, and has left an indelible mark on the younger children who he mentored. My son is devastated at his passing, but his memory is everlasting. I view him as a son, my son. Rest well, E. And finally, a tribute by our brother Nigel Lucas. He says, my brother, I have no words. I love you, David. I am here with you and Roxanne and your family. The Almighty has all the answers. No words to say. If I can help them anywhere more, even to listen, I'm here. I cannot imagine what you are going through, but I'm there with you, my brother. I can't truly know what you are feeling, but I'm feeling it this evening. God has the answers. I pray for comfort and healing for you and Roxanne and your family. My beautiful brother, I have no words. This is a text I never thought I would ever have to send to you. The strength of the Almighty is in you. The power of understanding of this universe and our human experience within it is all about life and death. And we both know and accept the truth of this incredibly difficult reality. He is in the bosom of Allah, greeted by his loving ancestors. You will now be guided by your angel, strengthened by your angel, comforted by your angel, reminded by your angel that your work is not done on this planet. And when it is done, he and every proud loving ancestor will be there waiting to receive you and your son. This life is temporary. We must finish our race before we give back to the embrace of the Almighty. No words. I have nothing to console you, my brother. Just for you to know that there is a nation of love behind you, and will continue to be with you and your families. Love is real. A parent's love is real. A child's love is real. That love does not disappear when the flesh and bone go. The spirit of love remains. So he is with you always. Strength to you, David. Love to you, David. I have no needs. I love you. Family, thank you for supporting.
Now we have a few tributes from people that have been involved in his life, so I still have a close case in Edwards.
A great deal of humility and responsibility. To say a few words on what Raheem, Birdie, Belgrave meant to some of us. My name is Jason Edwards, also known as Coach Man G. For many players, including Birdie, from the St. Mary's College football program, for which I was the head coach from 2006 to 2014. I remember when Coach Junior Maxwell told me about this 15-year-old upstart goalkeeper in 2008 that was ready to play for the Interpol team. I told Junior, we already have two keepers, and maybe we can look at them for next year. Junior, in his normal words, said, trust me, he is the real deal. I said okay to him, and we would look at him in training. In the next training session, I saw Birdie. And the first thing that came to mind was, this guy is crazy, has too much energy, is fearless, and had some gigantic calves. he would make the perfect goalkeeper for us. We really had some good times over the next 2 years, and he was one of our standouts. But he was a role model, a mentor, and a friend to many. We are all hurting. The sadness that we are feeling is unexplainable because it seems so unfit. I ask myself, why Birdie? Why did you pick him to go now, Lord? And why did you take one of the finest young men that I've ever come across? But I guess that's just it. We are not in control of our final destiny. And we know from Birdie's passing that we are never promised tomorrow. This is where faith comes in, and Birdie had a ton of it. We've been given a blessing to have been a part of his life, to learn from him, to watch him grow, to go into battle with him, to experience his presence in person, through the good times and bad. I believe with my whole heart that Brady would want us to be strong for him. As I thought about what I wanted to say today, I thought about you, Roxanne, and David, parents who lost their son. I thought about you, Adina, his sister who had just lost her brother. I thought a lot about his family and friends, and I wanted to end by saying this. Those who died yesterday had plans for this morning. And those who died this morning had plans for tonight. Don't take life for granted, because in the blink of an eye, everything can change. So forgive often and love with all your heart. And you may never know when you may not have that chance again. Once again, on behalf of myself, my wife, Paula, and my entire family, Coach Junior, and the whole of the Saints football family, our deepest condolences to the family and friends of the village. Thank you.
Next up is Jonathan George.
To give tribute to Raheem, wonderful young man. I had the opportunity to work with him, Jabalik. And it's always difficult in times like these, you know, here is for us, what are this for the family, right? Isaiah 7, verse 1 says, when the righteous are taken, no man takes the heart. And when these merciful men are lost, we don't consider that they are taken away from the ego to the God. But I know that a young man who displayed such character, that he was always brave, very coachable, open to learning. I remember when he was a youngster at the public, and before the training, he would stay on and look at the seniors in training. And after, he would come and ask questions about what he saw. And that always stuck with me. When he came back to me, I posted the picture because he also loved the water very much. And he saw I have it to be Maracas waterfall. And he reached out and said, am I a bit late? I didn't even think about that, to be honest. And it was too sensitive that I think that's something that I have to put on my bucket list to meet up with Maracas waterfall. Right? Take care to Mr. Roxanne and David. condolences and the God that you strength and peace in the sight of your husband.
I was still fast away. I didn't have a good way to come on.
As I was on my knee to this funeral, I was filled with hope, joy, and sadness. But obviously, you said such a gem, someone who was as close to perfect as I can get, as a human being. Of course, when I saw the old trapper, Manchester United fan, I realized he was blue. And so, but Birdie, I had the pleasure of working with him at a very young age. And from even that time, I could have seen that he was not great. In Islam, we have a different concept of death. There's no early departure, there's no going before the time. Because Allah says in the Quran that he will call someone in the infancy. Some at full strength, really was at full strength, and some in old age, after they have grown very much, and then have known the truth, which means that they have got seen that. So today, as I said, I feel grief, joy, and sadness, sadness on his passing, and joy knowing that he will enter paradise. Why am I sure? Why am I saying this? Because in Islam, there are certain types of deaths that guarantee the paradise. Drowning is one of those deaths. He has died as a man. So, I want to say all praise to Allah. I want to send my condolences out to the family and friends, his experience. And I am happy knowing that he got his just deserve in this life. Thank you.
I'm pleasure to say a few words on behalf of I think of Grandpa. Grandpa and I had a constant disturbance for the space whilst running to them. We had a very limited time to get there. We were concerned about arriving there. We knew it doesn't make it very long enough time and he did not drive breakfast. Lots of aberrations were left down there. One thing is clear, and by the way, Reverend Belgrave, it's a pleasure to have that to be his father. One thing is clear from what you have said to me, and that is that even though we are weak and we may hurt, yes, indeed, angry, anger is part of grief, we may be regret, but all of that will soon pass away because evidently this group knows that this is not the end of existence. Brother has left a great example for his friends. I have been communicating with a grandmother whose grandson went to school with Raheem. I did high school and then you. And I have told that lots of his friends are in pain. If you who are in pain can take a leaf out of Raheem's book and live life with a cautious awareness, then we don't know how long we have here. Just spend the time we have here in integrity, loving with the best we can. Then we will have nothing to fear. I leave with you this biblical text. In all your ways, have knowledge, God, and God will direct your paths. Thank you.
Thank you.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of God, the beneficent, the merciful. When I was asked to say a few words and given a very limited time to do so, I was indeed honored. I do not know, and I did not know Raheem well, but I know Brother David Muhammad, and I know Sister Roxanne, Sister Rock. And if you know the Father, you will know the Son. If you know the Father, you will know the Son. An amazing young man, strong, pure, intelligent, full of faith. Faith is not just the many lovely words we have said today that we have been blessed with in the Quran and the Gospel and the other scriptures that God has given us for guidance. Faith is embodying those words. Faith is acceptance of God's will. Faith is bearing these tests or these challenges or these blessings, however you look at it, with grace, with tears maybe, with sleepless nights maybe, but with acceptance that whatever is His will, is His will. And we journey closer to our Lord, all of us, every second. The Imam is not here with me today, my Father. And Birdie is not here with you today, Brother David. And I've been looking for our Father. I don't know if that works out yet. But if I have a short list for someone who could just maybe kind of somewhere close-ish fill those shoes, Brother David would be on that short list. And I try to make sure I listen to what he said before so that I would not repeat the same things he said. Because we speak the same language. Remember that we will meet our Lord soon. Soon. And live as Raheem did, preparing for that day. I pray that Allah opens the gates wide for him. And I pray that Allah's Rahman and Rahim, His mercy, is extended to every single one of us. We must live on and do what Allah, what God wants us to do. Let these difficult times change us for the better. Brother David, I hear you continually saying you're only son. Your hair is still black.
Allah alone knows what he has in store for you. And I may be a little bit younger than you, not sure your age. But I have 4 children so far, so in case you need some hints and advice, I'll give you some advice, inshallah. May Allah bless us all. Remember that we are continuously journeying towards our Lord. There is no one worthy of worship but Almighty God. Thank you very much. Peace and blessings be with you.
Raheem was my brother. Raheem was a brother to everyone I believe that he met. In the most unforeseen of ways, we became as close as family. I don't want to dwell on anything sad because Raheem's life was positivity and body. I believe everyone who knows him would agree. He was a person that was always happy, joyful, playful, so much so that it used to affect me in a way that, you know, I couldn't understand. It almost used to hurt how positive a light he was in every time that would come. Raheem was there for me in a lot of dark times that I didn't think that I would have had a friend to speak to about certain things. He was a person that I could have been my raw, uncut, natural way itself, and he wouldn't judge. He was the least judgmental person. He could fit into every possible scenario. He was not constrained with his view of society or what they thought of him. He was just himself. And that to me was something that I felt like, this is crazy that someone at his age could do, you know, go against the odds at all times. And I struggled for a while to try to understand how he did it, you know, and is he right or am I right? You know, like, what's the problem? But with this happening, I feel like, in a bittersweet way, I somehow know that Raheem lived his whole life doing everything he wanted to do. He did everything he said he was going to do. He was fearless. He never let anything hold him back. And I think that is an example that a lot of us could, you know, take moving forward. Live your life as best as you can because, you know, you never know. And I believe that he did just that. Raheem.
I believe that everyone here is blessed of known belief, including myself, who has known him for more than half of my life. It seems that we love football, and that was how our friendship started, sweating in the court in CIC. But putting football aside, just like many of you here today, I too had the honor of developing a special bond with him. We can all agree the massive heart he had and the impact he had on everyone around him. If you spent 5 minutes with Birdie, he was guaranteed to make you smile a lot. Birdie was there for me during a time when I was down in my life. He was front and center. Every day he would message, trying to plan different activities, whether it be a hike, a sweat, or a line. So for me, when he left for England, it was a bittersweet moment. I was happy for him pursuing his dreams, but sad because all the adventures would be limited to only when he visited. He was an ambitious, passionate, loving and adventurous woman. I'm blessed to have shared many memories with him, memories that I will cherish the rest of my life. One of my greatest memories with him will have to be last November when he surprised me by flying from England and showing up at the shoot to my wedding. I remember looking out the window and there he was. I remember the warm embrace he gave me and the big smile on his face. I will never forget this. I will be a memory that will forever be engraved in my heart. I know that I am only one of the countless persons who left his mark on this world. And for that, we all thank you. While it is difficult for me to stand here and bid you farewell for my good days, I love you, Billy. But you're the part of a group of friends about 12 of us. And between us, we had a special bond with every one of us, whether it be to go to the beach, a line, sweat, a hike. He spread himself with each and every one of us. So, on behalf of all of us, we thank you, Billy, and we love you. Keep on flying.
Good afternoon, everyone. When thinking what to say during my learning, I had a lot of memories. What's outstanding is that I'm going through the memories and it seemed to have any one of us. In addition, the two friendships, yeah, ups and downs, but the very game, I went on. It always seemed to be fun times. We had lots of adventures together. From sweats to midnight climbing and playing games to the morning, we had lots of memories together. It's one thing I'd always remember about Raheem is how positive he always was. To the people he encountered, and he always had time to have a friend. And I didn't know how he was playing a video game, or he, as simple as my last later time before certain shelter. Also thinking about you are that type of man. You go on this way and you didn't mind what you. One thing I always admire personally about Raheem is the respect he seems to give from his opponents while playing football. Whenever I watch his games, we meet someone from an opposing team. He always have a good rapport, offering them an encouragement or console. Never go solid for the winning team, never go solid for the losing team. Often because he was such a hard worker, always had a professional approach, but he was playing in the ball, Queen's Park Open, many other teams he played for. Even if it was a bad match, he was already ready to do what he did. One thing I remember also was the fact that he always knew the good food spots, whether it was for long hot dogs, or where he had the best levels, or even that ice cream, so I had to go to the gym. I remember when we replaced that thing. Was such a moment. He had such ambition to fly there, and he seemed to enjoy it, only sharing bits of the things he was doing. And I remember that time I met him in London. During my wife and I to Chinatown, and we walked on top, and he showed us around. We also took pictures with a giant Pikachu, and he carried us all like it was foolish just to wear a trumpet and boots. Also, I've been one of the adopted sons in Chinatown. I'm sorry that you're not here with us anymore, and a lot of adventures in this life together over. And many of them in the future mean a pretty soon. As much as I am sad to have lost you, I'm even happier to have met you. In closing, I'm happy to have called you my friend and your brother.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rashad Hyson. I want to thank everyone for coming out here to honor Raheem, Birdie, our team, Uncle Medina. We all love you, I appreciate you, and our thoughts and prayers. Before I start to speak about Birdie and his impact on my life and everyone's life, I just want everyone to turn to the back of the pamphlet. The poem. I don't think I've ever been in a space where anyone has called Birdie by his true name more than once, unless you're getting moved by Gansy. His name was Birdie. Birdie was 3 years before too. The last four lines of the poem says, I am in the woods that sing, I am in the kitchen of the living. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there, I do not die. I believe that it is God's will that they're talking about birds here. There's nobody really love to fly. I am 2 to 3 years younger than Birdie and his friends. Going into secondary school, my dad asked me, what school I wanted to go to? I immediately told him CIC. He said, why is CIC not that good right now? And I pointed out the fact that Birdie, Akil, Kieran, Carrie, Julian, Kevin, that whole group that was 2 to 3 years older than me, they all lived in a close distance to me. They were going to CIC, and I just wanted to be around them. I entered into CIC, I had my old friends. But every break time outside and after school, I would be around Birdie and his friends. My friends would be like, why are you not hanging out with us? Birdie's friends would be like, why are you not hanging out with your friends? And I would just stick up under Birdie, Akil, and the rest of the guys all the time. They would be walking home from school to city gates, and everybody would be this hat, and there's Rashad this hat. Until 4-3. Birdie gave me the nickname Pumman. Birdie said, Rasha, I like to do this nickname. You have to like with your own friends though. He's a big man. To this day, people don't even recognize me as Rashad. They recognize me as Papa. That's the kind of person who it is. I mean, and this one hit really hard. Last week, Saturday evening, I was having dinner with my family, and we just had a good time. And I was telling my little sister, I said, you know, Shakiri, I think that already said, stop calling myself Mama. And that's what people refer to my reaction, but they don't get older. For people to look at that certain way, Mama is a child, Shakiri. Fast forward to something. I saw him for the first time after 5 years. I was going to hike up on the top course, and Billy was going to hike up on the top course. So Billy came on the car, he saw me, he came on the car, we hugged each other. I said, Billy, I haven't seen him for 5 years. What's going on? Billy laughed, so we hugged. Then when he had gone, I said, Billy, come back somewhere, I haven't seen him so long. He was my brother. I love you. I said, well, you stood so? I said, you stood so, right? He laughed. We had Woody went on. And Woody went this direction. I went this direction. But the last thing I told Woody, we spoke, and he said, I'll check in this week, Rashad, because I see you moving out that thing all the time, so I'll check in. I said, Woody, no problem. Before Billy left, I said, Billy, I love you, I love you. Billy watched me. He said, boy, he stood so, and he chuckled. He said, no, Rashad, I love you too. I mean, I know this is God, everything is God's will. I know it's God's will, and I love you, and flesh, something like that. That is hard to grasp. But I believe to my being, to my calling, what everyone wants is for everyone to remember in such a light that whenever you think about Woody, whenever you speak about Woody, whenever you refer to Woody, it goes with a cup state mind as love. Woody was everybody gets a respectful, kind, caring, all of your above. Woody was love. Woody was loving. Love was good. Say God is love. God touched Woody and God impacted Woody in such a way that every time they spoke to Woody or around Woody, I believe that God was only met. Woody was love. I know it's a tough time, but it's also a beautiful time because Woody is closer to God now. And I believe that with this set of what he's telling us again, just like he told me last time I saw him, he loves us all. Don't be sad of me. Don't cry. He loves us. And we love him as well. So that's my piece of reality. All these CIC fellows, we have many CIC fellows in the room. And I can say, prayers are taught. Let's do a quick round of tasks. That's another chance we have for our time at CIC, or the CIC Fellowship Line. When you love this song, regardless of age, when you love this singing, you have the passion. And what's that? Yeah, what's that? Let's go.
I'm going to go to the next one. Without saying anything, and then we'd just be like, wow,
and then life will just continue as normal. It was so easy. It was so easy for all of us to figure out what we needed. It must have been becoming a part of each other's mind through this time. I can't help but think this was the universe's way of preparing me for this moment where you would no longer be here with me physically, but in my mind, in my heart, and my soul. I haven't physically touched you or helped you in 3 months, but it felt okay because we'd be on the phone like 10 times a day. With just talking about absolutely nothing, but just feeling comfortable with each other. And I realized that he brought that to a lot of you as well. We've grown so close, and I'm so grateful for how much we learned from each other. Me teaching you how to talk to party, and showing you all the top 10 music that I was listening to. Coming home and showing you what I learned in Krav Maga, even though you were terrified that I would like hit you or miss you, but I mean, it's fun to have you. You always brought me back to reality when I was telling about like a new guy that I was going on a date with. And before you even knew his name, you'd be like, alright, it was nice knowing you. Just before I left the house as well, you just always just like kept me grounded and balanced. I hope you don't forget to judge me for my future bad decisions and you're also stuck on this to stay me back on the right path. I love that we shared a lot of Kanye West as well. And all the new rap and dance battles in the kitchen were very good, but we always try to outdo each other. Thank you for trying to train me in the gym. We have already managed to do half a session with it, and then I've gone to the machine. But yeah, thanks for coming up with my complaints on that. I enjoy all these little moments we shared. I'll miss our walks to Shrap, but and the ice cream man that gave you free ice cream every time you went to buy because you spent so much money on his back. Our walks around Wembley and Westfield, never really buying anything, but just looking out and stuff in the board. You taught me patience, you taught me how to be calm in crisis. I'm not very good at still, but still learning. Your favorite words to say to me at least a few times a day would be stop waking up. I'd be like, no. But you just keep saying it anyway. Maybe it was your mantra because I've never seen you stressed out about anything in life. I will say that I stress enough for the both of us and he's calm enough for the both of us. You were always patient, even when it involved waiting for mommy at the center. When she said she'd be out in 5 minutes and you were calling me to pass the time and be on the phone with yourself an hour. And then you just every time we called, you just be telling me about who you're planning to see that day, what you're planning to do, what you're going to eat, everything. I've never spoken to anyone as much as I've spoken to you. I've never wanted to speak to anyone as much as I've spoken with you. Also, that's what you're trying to teach me to be better than my ass. It's the wrong thing, but we tried. The horrible game, but that's the right. I always said to you that I didn't want a son because of my experience with Peter. And also because I did the things I went through for and but now I have one. So I hope to find someone that you would have come to. Someone that's kind, caring, friendly, loving, funny, adventurous as you. I know you'll help me and you'll be with me throughout my life. I can't touch you, but I can feel you. I'm so happy that you found true happiness at the end. When we visited Brandy and you had her come to you, either it was distressed trim or just your soul radiating, ready to ascend. That was the day before you go away. It always makes sense that you finally got back to got to go back to Trinidad after all these years. Seeing your friends, seeing your family members that you were out of touch with for a while. I remember watching you and texting you at our Jimmy's funeral last month. And here we are. Here you are watching us at your funeral. Sorry, I'm not working. To my next of kin,
my emergency contacts, my friends to refer for any free stuff, my neighbor, my roommate, my children's alcohol, my children are meeting on my path, a friend to many, a best friend to a select youth, a golden son, and my beloved angel brother. I've never stopped loving you. And for all the things that you do, we can't wait to see you there.
Thank you.
Thank you for having a chance to see the space in the auditorium and in the volume process. You don't have time to leave it on top of something of great reasons. Do preserve the place of that.
About to die, 1%.
Yes. Raheem was a fun, loving character, and it was a pleasure and an honour to play alongside him as well as know him. Raheem used to always make me laugh, with a smile on his face, and was always telling jokes. For example, with me and him used to literally go back and forth, mimicking each other's accents during the game. And this is when we were supposed to be defending, actually focusing on the game, but we had time to do that. And that's what he brought that sense of fun back to the game. And I'm surely really gonna miss that as well. But that's not just all he did. He was always there for the young players, helping support, mentor them, and that's what he should be remembered for, and that's what he'll always be remembered for. He's always there to just be on hand and support us all, and we're surely gonna miss him, myself, the players, and that's the effect he's had on anyone he's known. He's literally affected all our lives. But Raheem, my brother, just obviously I wish you all the best in the afterlife and the rest in eternal peace, and may God protect you now and forever. Thank you.
So guys, thank you for coming as you say goodbye to Raheem. In one word, what did Raheem mean to you?
A brother. Friendship.
Magnetic. Honest. Angel. Loyal. Lovely. Genuine.
Famous.
Joy.
Pure.
Family. Loving.
Bravo.
Sweetness.
So Raheem from Lyman. And me. Just genuine. Accepting. Take care.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I know you as a father. In the goodness of God. Yeah. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Oh, yes, you have. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made. Of the goodness of God.
Among the shadows, you wiped my tears away, and I felt the pain of heartbreak, and I've seen the brighter days, and I've prayed prayers to heaven from my lowest place, and I have held the blessings, God, you give and take away. No matter what I have, your grace is enough. On the mountains, I will bow my life to the one who sent me there. In the valley, I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. Your God heals and valleys. Yeah, it heals and matters. Yeah, it heals and matters. And I am not alone. I have watched my dreams get broken. In you, I hope will play. No matter what, I know I'm safe inside your hands. On the mountains, I my life to the one who sent me there. In the valley, I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. Your God over here heals and guides. I am not.
keep.